Hello and welcome to our special show on coronavirus, where we're asking you to call in and ask any queries, any questions that you may have on the disease, anything that you may want to know. We'll be joined by doctors who'll take all your questions. We're joined this morning by Dr. Jalaja Ramesh, Senior Consultant Diabetologist, St. Isabel's Hospital, Chennai. Dr. Ravikant Patil, Consultant and Interventional Cardiologist, Seva Southern Lifeline Super Speciality Hospital, Miraj. And Dr. Sinaj Chandran, Consultant Physician and Diabetologist, Sunrise Hospital, Cochin. Thank you so much, doctors, for taking our time and joining us this morning and, you know, taking everybody's questions. And I'd like to start with a question of my own, an issue that is something that's being talked about. Now, the Association of Healthcare Providers has said in a statement that herd immunity could be the only way to control COVID, you know, because we're going now into what's being referred to as lockdown 4, where we're going to see a lot of easing of restrictions. Now, the association has said that the vaccine and effective drug may take time, and herd immunity is the only answer to COVID. So I'd really like to know what is it that you feel on this particular issue, because this is a controversial issue. 80% of the population then would have had to develop immunity to coronavirus. If we could start with you, Dr. Ramesh.
It's true. Herd immunity means, in particular, about 80 to 90% of the population become immune to an infectious disease called herd immunity. But what happens is, in the coronavirus, though the fatality rate is about 3.5%, if a herd immunity is not the only answer, a vaccine should be the better one, because what will happen, the high-risk population can go into a lot of complications. It can lead into deadly complications also. So vaccine should be better instead of herd immunity for this coronavirus.
Right. In the statement, opinion. They also obviously go on to say that how we must protect, you know, the vulnerable, and that we can't stay under lockdown forever while we're awaiting this vaccine. Dr. Patil, and this is something, as you know, all the doctors have been saying, those who are especially vulnerable, which is people with heart problems, with diabetes, they're the ones who need to be very careful. So what would you say on this recommendation?
Basically, herd immunity develops only when the people go outside and then they have some contact with the viruses and they develop their own immunity. In some of the countries, the people who are the age of less than 10 and more than 75 are told to stay at home, and remaining young people or young population told to move around. So can they develop a herd immunity that will affect the better control over the virus as its own individual control? That's what I say. In as case of a heart disease, I will always suggest the patient who has got a diabetes, who has got a previous coronary artery disease, or who has got a hypertension, has got a high chance of getting the coronavirus infection. So better they should stay at home and should always follow all those specifications what has been told to them.
Right. And Dr. Chandran, do you feel that, you know, we can't wait endlessly for this vaccine, and the suggestion being that we should now open up and herd immunity could be the only way to protect the population?
Good morning, ma'am. The answer to the question could be like this. You know, when we say that around 70 to 80% people need to get infected to develop, and out of the 70 to 80%, even if around 2% or 3% develops fatalities or comorbidities, or, you know, they get into real, you know, tight situations, or, you know, they become acutely sick, that itself will be a huge number for us to tackle. So I think herd immunity is a good concept, because we all want to listen, you know, what is good. So I think it's a wishful thinking. It's a good concept, you know, but practically in a huge country like India, even when so many people get infected, out of that itself, there is around at least 5 to 10% of people, you know, who can get into very worst bad outcomes. So we need to, you know, open up this country. Yes, the economy is in trouble. The Prime Minister is on the correct direction to doing so. But, you know, we also need to be quite careful on how we should open and how the pace we need to decide on what to be open first and what to do the last.
All right. The suggestion was also that it should be left a lot to chief ministers, and how certain areas should, you know, we need to reduce the area of the containment zones, really make them more specific so that economic activity can begin in other areas. Well, we have our first caller. We have Irshad Ahmed calling from Patna. Go ahead with your question.
What is your opinion, doctor, about the observation of World Health Organization that coronavirus causes COVID-19 could become endemic like HIV? It will never go.
All right, so that was the statement yesterday by WHO saying that we may have coronavirus, around forever, Dr. Ramesh?
It's true to some extent because generally this RNAs like R virus, like if you take herpes virus or if you take HIV virus, they always remain for a longer period of time. Like that, the corona also got chances to remain for a longer period of time. Have to wait and watch only.
All right, and but how are we as a public, supposed to deal with this information, Dr. Patil? It's something that I suppose is very frightening to hear that this is going to be around forever. But at the same time, like with H1N1, we also have viral coming back every other year. We do have a vaccine for it as well, though there is a mutation also being talked about.
Yeah, I think there is nothing to frighten in this statement because there are all the viruses. Most of the viruses are stayed back in this country. Like we had a SARS, we had a swine flu, we had so many other viruses which are there. This is a part of their process. The only thing is fatality rate is very less, will become very less as the things go ahead. And corona, the only important thing is it spreads very fast. That is the only thing that worries us. But once we develop a good kind of immunity, we have a different vaccine with us. And then there are some few cases will going to come up every year again and again, but then we can tackle it with our own healthcare facilities at that time. That's how I feel. So nothing to get worried about.
Nothing to get very worried about. We have another caller, Sumedh from Delhi. Go ahead with your question.
Hello.
Yes, go ahead.
See, I want to ask the doctor, that every case that seems to be coming with the symptoms of coronavirus is being classified as a corona case. What kind of this thing is this? This is a total fraud on the people. Everyone, you make a corona patient without, you don't have all the testing facilities and you make everybody a corona patient. How is that possible?
But how is everybody being made a corona patient? We do have to have them tested and that's when, that they're categorized as a coronavirus patient.
Hello?
All right, well, I'll go across to Dr. Chandran for that. A very agitated person there, asking how is everybody being called a corona patient, who are suffering from a cough cold.
No, now the thing is that whenever somebody comes to the hospital with symptoms which can resemble the disease, it is up to the doctors or healthcare providers to look into it, okay? So it is not like that when we have a huge country, when we have limited testing facilities, when we have such a huge crowd. So it is not very simple that you can tell you that you are just having a common cold, go home. It is just that anyone having symptoms needs to be evaluated. Unless otherwise proved in any part of the world right now, a person who has symptoms needs to be considered as positive. So there is nothing wrong in doctors looking at with a suspicious eye or ear, because it is important for us to know whether the person who is sitting in front of us really has this problem. So we may go ahead and, look at various tests or clinical scenarios and have a detailed examination. So may ask you to be on quarantine for a few days. It all depends from person to person. So I don't think there is anything wrong in doing that. It is just not that everyone comes in are basically branded as corona and being treated. It is just that we need to have a suspicious eye in this matter.
Right, and that's the reason perhaps we didn't take enough precautions earlier, and a lot of normal patients who were just there for cough and cold turned out to be corona patients, and then we had situations where doctors and nurses have also been infected. We have another caller from Hyderabad, Dr. Ramana Rao. Go ahead with your question.
Good morning to all of you.
Morning.
My question is regarding one of my cousin and cousin brother is having TB and one is on dialysis. We are residing in red zone. What are the precautions we have to take regarding TB and dialysis patient?
All right, Dr. Ramesh?
He has to continue with the tuberculosis treatment and he has to give a high protein diet and we have to monitor his liver enzyme. And regarding dialysis, you have to continue dialysis because you have to keep the urea creatinine under control. So if you follow this, you'll be safe. And as for anybody else, the physical distancing, social distancing, frequent hand wash, the respiratory hygiene, doing breathing exercise, taking foods which can improve your immunity, if you follow this, you'll be all right.
All right. We have another caller from Chennai. Ashwin, go ahead with your question.
Good morning. Like every other layman in this country, I've been talking from one channel, calling up one channel to another, talking about, asking about plasma therapy to herd immunity, even in the beginning, to asymptotic patients. Now, because the herd immunity, I want a very, very specific question, because I'm calling from Chennai, and about a week back, the government, the Chennai, whole of Chennai is a red zone. And the government said 98% of Chennai are asymptomatic. Okay. Now, the question which I want to be, with respect to herd immunity, is very specific. One, if there are a super spreader or silent spreader asymptomatic patients, if 98% of the population is basically asymptomatic, which means, is it right to make experiment the herd immunity, because technically all of us are already affected or infected with? And two, more importantly, do we have, if people who have been asymptomatic, do they have, obviously there has to be some kind of an antibody, that's why people are asymptomatic, right? Do people have, who are asymptomatic, have a higher chance of being immune than those who are not? That's the question.
All right. First, Dr. Ramesh, if you could take that question.
Yeah, I'd like to answer for the first question, second question. Yes, asymptomatic means they may not have symptom, but corona has got a long incubation period. They may become symptomatic in the later part, say within a 7th day or 14th day or even 20th day also. But asymptomatic people also can spread the infections. To some extent, yes, because the body develop immunity also, they are asymptomatic. And second is herd immunity concept is, which already doctors, we already discussed. Herd immunity is really a good positive thought, but thing is that in our country, like which is a thickly populated, 1.3 billion people, of that 3% of the people become infected also, it will become a lot of casualties and medical stress on the medical faculties.
Right.
So herd immunity has to be implemented. We cannot be being in a lockdown for a longer period of time. Slowly, as in other countries where younger generation are slowly introduced, like that you have to go. It all will right. Settle in due course.
Right, Dr. Mehta, since you belong to Chennai, I thought you should take that question. But Dr. Chandran, you could also come in here. What is your view on this?
See, ma'am, the thing is, like, there are a lot of asymptomatic carriers. That is, if we see a person who has got absolutely no symptoms, and if we test that particular gentleman or lady, could still be positive for the virus. So it is not that everyone who is basically having no symptoms are not having exposure to the virus. So we don't have means for mass testing. It is a huge thing, you know. To screen entire Bombay or entire Chennai, it may not be possible for us to do it, to have a mass screening. It may come later, but at the moment, we do not have that. So at the moment, what we need to do is, we just need to stay indoors, keep physical distancing, start slowly opening up the economic things. And I think if you look at the history, all endemics in this of mankind have ended up either in people living with the problem or development of a vaccine. So I think we just need to work out on the vaccine part, which is very challenging, and it may still take months or probably years to come. And, you know, the infectivity rate is going to come down slowly, and we are slowly going to develop some amount of immunity. I may not be able to predict and how that is going to come, because the antigenicity of this virus itself is not fully understood. So we just need to take precautions. And regarding the gentleman's question, whether 98% having asymptomatic, does that, you know, puts you in a comfortable zone? My answer would be definitely no.
All right. Well, time for us to slip into a short break. It's always surprising that there's just so much about this disease that we still don't know. It's like we're fighting it on one hand, and we're researching it and trying to discover more about it at the same time. Well, we'll slip into a short break and be back with more. Stay with us. Welcome back to our special show. We're taking all your questions on coronavirus, and our doctors are answering them for you. We have a caller from Delhi. Anita, go ahead with your question.
Yeah. I am a wheelchair user. I've had polio since the age of 2. So when doctors say that, you know, keep the shoes out and all that, so now how can I keep the wheelchair out? The wheelchair will come inside, right? And also, I think when as a polio person, I had a mitral valve, you know, which means I'm on anticoagulant. So how is it going to make a difference? And of course, for the disabled people, special needs are there, you know, of accessibility and all. So I just want to know about the from the doctor as to what advice can be given.
All right, so very challenging situation in terms of when we talk about, you know, maintaining certain norms for coronavirus. Dr. Patil, what would you say?
There are two issues here. One, that she has a mitral wall replacement and she is on anticoagulation. So these are the high-risk cases which has got a higher chance of transmission and the risk for the coronavirus. So as far as possible, the social distancing is the most important thing that I will recommend for her. So this is what she can do best. Try to avoid any contacts which are coming inside. That is the most thing important. Because, and the second thing is anticoagulation she is taking. So this drug actually does not interfere with any of your disease process. Any means it doesn't have any effect on a corona. Corona doesn't have any effect on these viruses, so there is no higher chances because of your taking the drug. Now, as part of a disability, I know that you can't do most of the social norms what they are telling, but I think social distancing, what you can practice, that is the most important thing.
And try and avoid going out as much as you possibly can.
As much as possible.
Yes, we have as another caller from Chennai. Natarajan, go ahead with your question.
Good morning, doctors. See, we all know that Chennai is up for hospitals. See, now, many doctors are wondering, none of the cases they are receiving, either it is gynecology or ortho or neurology, they are wondering, where are my cases? Actually, even the caesarean cases are being converted into normal cases. Now, everybody is worried. Actually, what is going on, doctor? Can you please explain?
All right, Dr. Ramesh, again, since you're from Chennai, if you could take that question.
Sir, it's not like that, sir. Like the caesarean cannot be converted into normal. See, generally, whatever the obstetric complications or obstetric problem, we decide the delivery about it. And majority of the cases we are able to manage in the teleconsultation, except caesarean and emergency surgeries, we are just carried out. Gynec, all the gynec obstetric issues have been handled. I work in a corporate hospital where we conduct deliveries, and it's not that normal deliveries, caesareans are converted into normal delivery.
All.
We are attending, sir. Majority of things we are attending by teleconference or telecommunications or teleconsultations.
All right. So in Chennai, clearly a lot of people are worried. And Dr. Chandran, of course, Kerala has been a big success story. If you talk about the way that they've managed to, you know, control the spread of the virus, if you could also talk a bit about what is it like now?
Yeah, we have been doing extremely well, and I think we probably had the lowest mortality rate in the entire world. But, you know, once the experts have started coming back, I think for the last 48 hours, we have had a small spike in cases. It's still manageable. But I think, you know, we are just continuing to be vigilant out here. And the contact tracing and, you know, the success in Kerala is that the people are involved in the whole movement. Whether it is the primary care worker, the doctors, the nurses, even the local administration, even the panchayat, all these people are working in tandem for contact tracing, to support people. And I think that is the Kerala model. And since we are a little bit, I'm happy to say that people are a little outgoing in coming out and telling them that I probably may have a problem, so please. And the voluntary information is being passed from person to person. And you know, we are also using telemedicine and communication apparatus effectively so that we can do contact tracing and, you know, interfere at a very early stage. I think that is the answer for the question.
All right. And Dr. Patil, we've had a, you know, whole range of questions, but really a lot of people concerned with the lifting of the restrictions and, you know, what it's going to be like next week when we go into this lockdown 4.0 phase, which is basically an easing of the lockdown. So your advice?
So corona is not gone. Corona is still there. The lockdown has reduced, but the most important thing, we are still in a pandemic of a corona. So the corona scare is still high. So the most important thing for the people is the social distancing, hand washing, and taking all the precautions that they can take that they should have a prevent the infection of a corona. So just it is lockdown is over. Just remember that corona is not over.
Absolutely. Something very important for everyone to realize, even though you may be out and about more, you have to take all those precautions because coronavirus is here and, you know, we're still waiting for that vaccine and cure. Thank you so much, doctors, for taking our time and answering all those questions. Thank you all for watching at home. Time for us to slip into a short break. We'll return with all the latest updates.